Well, good morning, Rainbow Press. So good to see all of you guys here today. You look wonderful. Excited to worship the Lord together. Would you go ahead and stand to your feet if you're able today? God has called us. He has called us together to worship Him today. And man, I'm just so glad that we are in fellowship together as one body, one people today. So let's worship with all we have from the Word. In Psalm 150, let's sing this together. Praise the Lord.
Host, you trace the mountain peaks, you paint the evening sky with wonders. The earth, it is your throne, from desert to the sea, all nature testifies your splendor. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. The Lord, raise your voice, you heights and all you depths, from furthest east to west, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. You reached into the dust, in love your spirit breathed. You formed us in your very likeness, to know your wondrous works, to tell your mighty deeds, to join the everlasting chorus. Praise the Lord.
Church, you can be seated.
morning to you. We're delighted that you're here and you've gathered with us for worship. If you're our guest this morning, welcome. We're glad that you're here. We want to call one another to our sacred privilege and joy and delight this morning using the scripture from Isaiah 41. Hear the word of God. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Let's pray together. God, our Heavenly Father, we come to adore and magnify your name, to add our voices to the voices of the angels and the archangels. Thank you that Jesus Christ is the Son of Man. He's entered into the throne room of heaven, and he has been given a dominion, an eternal dominion, an everlasting kingdom, and people of all languages, all nations, all tribes will bow down and worship. And we are so thankful for the privilege that you've given us this day to bow our knee and to confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, that you've given us a firm anchor for the turbulent seas of our lives, your word. And so, Lord, we thank you for the precious and powerful promises of your word. And we pray today, Lord, as we sing, that you'll not only ignite our hearts, but renew our capacity to trust you, that you always do what you promise. So today, would you hold us in the palm of your hand? Would you prove yourself the good shepherd carrying the lambs close to your heart? And we would ask you now to come and minister so that we find grace to help each of us in our particular need as we worship you. We make our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Church, would you stand together once more if you're able today as we sing How Firm a Foundation, this great hymn that speaks of our foundation in God's word, his excellent word. Let's sing this together.
How firm a foundation your saints of the Lord is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can you say than to you he has sent, to you who remembers who Jesus have led? Fear not, I am ready.
Amen. You can be seated. When we come to a moment today where we're going to confess our sins corporately to the Lord. You have a prayer in your worship guide this morning that you can make use of. And just as we discussed in Sunday school with our adult Sunday school class just recently, our sin, such were some of you. That's what the word says. Like any sin that we commit, we were this, but that's not our identity. That is not who we are in Christ anymore. Christ has paid for our sin. He has paid for all of our sins, past, present, and future. But we always come before the Lord knowing that this week that we have sinned, like we still sin, right? So we have sinned. So we want to come before the Lord confessing together as the church. So you have a prayer in your worship guide there. We'll give you just a few moments of silence that you can make use of that prayer that we have in your worship guide to express our confession of sin to Him. Let's do that. Let's pray together. Our Father, through Jesus, your Son, we pray that you would forgive us for the ways that we have resisted your ways and promoted ourselves at the expense of others. Father, we want to be servants just like Jesus was a servant. And many times we demand our own way. And at the root of all of our sin, at the root of all the things that we do, we understand that pride is there. So, Father, would you crucify our sin just as Jesus was crucified on the cross? Or may we kill it today and lay it at your feet? Because we pray this in the name of our crucified, risen, and exalted King, Jesus Christ. Amen. Church, we know as we confess our sin together that we can be assured that we have forgiveness. And this morning we hear the word of the Lord from 1 John chapter 3, verse 16, that says, "By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers." Amen. We're going to profess our faith together with the Apostles' Creed. You'll see that in your worship guide. It'll be on the screen as well, I believe. So with all of your heart, we'll profess this today. Let's do that. Here we go. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And we believe it. Would you stand together to your feet once again if you're able as we sing? Everything is under our Father's control. Everything is under our Father's hand. And this is my Father's world. It's hymn number 58. Amen, church. You can be seated.
Would you join me in prayer, please? Father, we come before you and we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ who gave his all to rescue us, not when we had it all together, but when we were ungodly, when we were rebels without a cause, when we were thumbing our nose at you. You came and you sought us, you found us, you pursued us, you made us your own, you transformed our hearts. You cause us to be born again into a living hope. And for this, we give you thanks and praise. Lord, we would pray and thank you today for the great things that you've done for us this week. We thank you so much that Donald and Peggy are home from Nairobi, Kenya, that you've brought them safely home back to us. And we give you thanks and praise for all the things that you have done for them. We pray you'll do the same for Wade and the last team that's coming home this day from Tanzania. Would you bring them safely home and give them a sweet reunion with their family and with us? And we look forward to all the reports of what you've done in Africa this summer. Father, thank you that the gospel makes us a people for others, and that this church and many different ministries in our community, in many different ways, and many, many partners strung throughout the world, that your gospel is going forth, and we pray that it would bear fruit today. We do thank you so much for the Alexander family and for a First Baptist Church here in Gadsden. And we pray, oh Lord, that that church would, you would expand their tent, that you would cause them to be fruitful and effective in your kingdom enterprise, and that you would bless the staff and the leaders of that church, and they would be anointed of you to take the gospel here in our city, that the gospel would make progress through them here and around the world. Thank you for the privilege that we have to partner with our sister churches here. And so, Lord, we want to make much of Jesus today, and we pray, Lord, as you're lifted up in these churches, that you would draw boys and girls and men and women to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. So that's our desire here today as we come to feast upon your word and at your table, Lord, minister your grace. Lavish it upon us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, good morning to you. Just want to let you know we're glad that you're here. A number of you are guests. So thankful for you. We do not have children's church, but if parents are in a panic, we do have, Tori has all kinds of resources on the round table for kids to use and to kind of keep kids' attention during service. So if you need to get up right now and go and check that out, that's perfectly acceptable. I do want to just call your attention to a couple of announcements. Women, we do have our next women's summer session tomorrow night at 7 o'clock at the Herrings. And just want to just let you know that Christy Herrick of Briarwood Church is going to be speaking to our women. And just want to encourage you to come for that fellowship. We're delighted to... The women's ministry in this church is one of the hallmark ministries that we're very grateful for. When our women are strong, our families are strong, and our church is strong. So I would just encourage you to come, to bring a friend. You'll be ministered to for sure. On the back of your bulletin, there's these QR codes. If you want to, if you don't know what that's about, you can be baptized into modern technology. If you need to update, if you need to update your personal information on our records, or you'd like to let us know that you're here, you can click on the first one with your phone app, your camera app. We're pretty serious, and I'm going to talk about this in my sermon. Pray for me campaign. So many young people are leaving the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ today, regardless of denomination. And one of the hallmarks that is true of young men and women when they leave home, why they do not leave their faith behind, is that they have cross-generational relationships. People that were their Sunday school teacher, their youth group leader, their small group leader that invested in them. And so what we're trying to do is to raise up, and right now I'll just unashamedly make a plug, we need more men to sign up for our Pray For Me campaign. We're wanting every single youth, every child in this church, and many of our youth that come to our ministries are not, their families don't come to worship here. But they need somebody here who's willing to pray for them to take their name before the throne of God in heaven on a regular basis. We'll give you all the resources, show you how to do that. That's the second thing. And just thank you so much. After COVID, we've never gone back to the passing the plate, but our giving has never been stronger. And so there's ways to give there. So I just want to call your attention to that. And now I want to invite you to take your Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 20. And as you're turning there, I do want to call attention to what's before you, and that is the Lord's table. We're going to come in just a moment to what we call the Lord's Supper, to communion. It is not Rainbow Presbyterian Church's table, it's the Lord's table. And so if your faith is in Jesus Christ, if you're a baptized member in a church that preaches the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, you are welcome at this table. If you haven't yet crossed the line over into faith, I want you to take this time, not to take these elements, but to take Jesus Christ and to see that he shed his blood, his body was broken to reconcile you to God, to cause you to come out of death into life, to cause you to be born again, to cause you to trust in him. And so these are emblems of his amazing grace. And so I want to encourage you, one logistic, those of you who are guests, for you who are regulars around here, you can turn me off now, but we believe that communion, the Lord's Supper, is the altar call of the church. Long before 1850 and Charles Finney, that communion served as the altar call of the church. And therefore, we want you to come forward, those of you who can. If you can't, just wave your hand, and we'll visit you. Our elders will visit you with the bread and the cup. But guys right here, you guys right here down this middle aisle, if you'll come this way and cycle back out like that, okay? And if you'll hold the elements, and what we're going to do is we're going to take it together, remembering that Jesus Christ is the head of the church, and we are his body, and we're going to take it together, symbolizing that. You guys here and here, come right down this aisle here and circle back out here to your pew, okay? Matthew 20. We're in a series entitled Life Centered on the King. All of us have a center. In this passage, we're going to talk today about the desire that we all have, desire to be great, desire to do great things, the William Carey, to attempt great things for God and to expect great things from God. But many times, we center our lives on the things of this world, what people think about us, how well our children are doing, how well our grandchildren are doing, how well our business is doing, how well our bank account and our brokerage accounts are doing. And all of those things fluctuate, and it is nothing to center our life on. It's not a solid foundation. And Matthew, in his gospel, is writing to Messianic Jews, people who are coming out of Judaism, to placing their faith in Jesus as the Messiah, that we center our life upon him and his teaching. He is the Lord, he is the Master, and we are his servants. And today we're going to come to talk about true greatness. What does it look like to aspire to be truly great? And all you have to do is go to the theaters. I've been to the theaters here recently, and you can see in abundance the desire to be great. Pilots are seeking the coveted position of being Top Gun. And they have to rein in their monstrous egos and to learn that their mission is never going to be successful if they continue on their ego trip, individualistic approach to flying. They have to learn to rein that in and work as a team. Well, this weekend, I went, in my mind's eye, I went back to a place that I love very dearly because it's the place that birthed the Kings. B.B. King, the king of the blues. And Elvis, the king of rock and roll. And I went to see the movie and to see one little nuance of Elvis's life that I didn't know about is Colonel Tom Parker, who was his agent. And his maniacal desire for greatness and his greed for wealth and how it enslaved him and basically unraveled his life as well as that of the king of rock and roll. Well, One of the things I want you to see, this desire for greatness, this ambition that can be so unrestrained and get out of hand so quickly in a business relationship, in family relationships, even in church, that it's not something just for the fighter pilots at the Top Gun school and the hangar in which they live and work. It's not so much just something that talented musicians that live on the stage struggle with. It's something that you and I, every single day of our life, have to monitor and be very careful about. You see, there's another band of followers of Jesus that were struggling with unrestrained ambition and a desire for greatness. They were status seekers. Their ego was a bit unchecked, and it was already splintering this small band of Jesus' followers. And in this passage, in Matthew 20, Jesus basically sets forth that three things I want us to focus on, and we're going to focus mainly on the last one, the enemy of true greatness, okay? I want you to see this in Matthew 20, verses 20 to 24. There's an enemy of true greatness defined by Jesus Christ. What's the essence? What's the secret of true greatness? That's going to be 25 to 27. 28, verse 28, is the embodiment, the example of true greatness. And one of the things I'm going to go ahead and just fast forward here, because I can't tell you how many times I've preached on a passage like this. And all of y'all out there are like me. I'm allergic to serving. You want to know how far I've come along in viewing myself as a servant? When you treat me as a servant, when people treat you as a servant at home, when people leave the dishes in the sink, when they leave the clothes strewn all over the floor, how do you feel? You want a piece of me? You know, I'm not much of a servant. You get those dishes in the dishwasher. One of the things I want us to see this morning is the enemy of true greatness is summarized in one word: ego. Ego. And we're going to see this. I was noticing this week, preparing for this, I've learned a lot, and I've used this a good bit in trying to help parents with their teenagers, of helicopter parenting. You heard of that before? Of parents that kind of hover over their kids, have a hard time letting go. Anybody struggle with control issues here? Have you ever heard of snowplow parenting? Snowplow parenting? Parents that don't want their kids to experience any adversity. If they get the poor teacher, by golly, I'm going to call the administrator at Euro Brown School, and we're going to get that teacher assignment changed. We don't want our kids to experience anything difficult, any adversity. And kids that grow up in the homes of snowplow parents, they cannot live in the world that you and I live in. They're deflated. They're demoralized. They cannot deal with adversity. You know, that's not something that is that first world wealthy parents in America struggled with. Right here in this text, you got snowplow parenting going on, okay? The first snowplow parent, Salome, we believe is her name. She was sister to Mary, the mother of Jesus, and we're going to cash in a little bit of our family privilege. And my two boys, Jesus said that they were going to sit on the thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Okay, so this request is not crazy out of hand. Matthew 19, 28, that's what Jesus said. You're going to enter into my kingdom, and you're going to reign with me, and you're going to sit on 12 thrones. And all Salome is saying is, I want my boys to have the positions of preeminence. I want them to be on the right and the left. And it's kind of interesting as it kind of goes along. In verse 20, it says, the mother of the sons of Zebedee, the sons of thunder, their names were James and John. They came up to him with her sons, kneeling before him, and she asked him for something. Don't we always come to Jesus? I frequently come to Jesus. I have an agenda, and Lord, would you please bless my agenda? Get on board my plan rather than, Lord, what is your plan? I don't know how you go about making your plans, but I've had to learn that's not the right way. But Jesus says to her, he's so tender, he's so kind, he actually never rebukes them for their request. He says, what do you want? She said to him, say that these two sons of mine are to sit one on your right hand and one on your left in your kingdom. Then Jesus answered, you do not know what you're asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I am to drink? Notice the cup. It's going to be repeated. They said to him, we are able. They underestimated their great weakness. He said to them, you will drink my cup, but to sit at my right hand and at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared by my Father. And when the 10 heard it, they were indignant at the two brothers. Now, they were not indignant and furious that they were so righteous and wanting to serve, and these people were just unrestrained, self-seeking. No, they were aroused with a proud, competitive spirit. Why didn't we think about this? And so one of the things I want you to see is that when I mention the word ego, that the way the world defines greatness, it's not by serving, it's by exercising authority, it's by ruling, it's by being a person that you tell other people what to do. Here, ego is just an exaggerated sense of self-importance, an exaggerated sense of our own abilities. It's self-reliance. And I want you to notice two things. One is the effect of this upon themselves. Of all that they wanted to do, they're self-focused. The effect of it is that they begin to minimize the sovereignty of God. My place, my position, your place, your position in the everlasting eternal kingdom, your particular place and position in the Lord's church today. It is by divine appointment. It is, the phrase here is prepared by my Father. That these positions aren't mine to give. These are prepared by my Father who is in heaven. And so they lose sight of that. They get big and God gets smaller. The next thing is how it affects other people. Always when we get self-focused. In fact, as I was thinking about this week, the crazy things that you can find online. You can go find out the 25 famous rock and roll bands that were obliterated because of unchecked, unrestrained ego. Can you think of any? Well, there's some like, Black Sabbath. How about that one? Cream. How about the Beatles? Just the incredible genius of the Beatles, all sort of just abruptly ending because of what we're talking about here, an exaggerated sense that I'm the most important member of this band, and if you don't have me, you don't have this band. How about you guys, y'all love your teams here in Alabama. How many great teams have come up short of their potential because of ego, an inflated, exaggerated sense of self-importance, where we started seeking their own preeminence over that of the team? How many business partnerships have just been obliterated because people got too focused on themselves and protecting their own turf and making a name for themselves? But it's interesting. One of the things I do as a church leader is this is not something that is out there. It's very much something that is inside the church. And I read a book at least once a year. It's by a man named Henry Nouwen. It's called In the Name of Jesus, and it's called Reflections on Christian Leadership, on Servant Leadership. And that's basically what Jesus is talking about here. Long before Robert Greenleaf, if you ever studied anything about leadership in college, in 1970, he came up with the concept of servant leadership. Well, he R&D'd it. He robbed and duplicated it from Jesus here in this passage. But Henry Nouwen says, one of the greatest ironies of the history of Christianity is that its leaders have given constantly in. They've given in constantly to the temptation to power, political power, military power, economic power, moral and spiritual power, even though they continue to speak in the name of Jesus. Jesus is the one who did not cling to his divine power, but he emptied himself and became a servant. Whether you're parenting, whether you're leading a church, whether you're leading a medical practice, whatever it is, it's easier to adopt the approach of power and control rather than do the hard work of loving and serving in Jesus' name. Now, one of the things I want to make a specific application here. I was working through this passage and just praying through it for myself. And one of the things that just sort of hit me like a ton of bricks, and here's my prayer. Lord, please, Father, overhaul, renovate, transform my perspective on greatness. Too often I am led by the world's perspective of greatness, status seeking, making a name for myself. Free me from being ego-driven in my own leadership, attempting to make a name for myself, even when I serve you. Have you ever struggled with that? Well, one of the things I'm going to talk about in just a minute, Jesus Christ has come to serve the ego-driven people of the world who were full of themselves, to lead you to the foot of the cross, and to embrace him. Well, the next thing I want you to see, the enemy of true greatness is ego. All of us struggle with this. The essence of true greatness is now found for us in 25 to 27. Hear the word of God. But Jesus called them to him and said, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles, the rulers of the nations, lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. It shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be your slave. So what's the secret to true greatness, according to Jesus? What is the essence of it? How do you boil this down into like one sentence? Well, here is a sentence that I've kind of adapted a little bit from one of my favorite preachers. His name is John Charles Ryle from Liverpool, England. He lived a long time ago. According to Jesus, a life, and here comes some important words, a life of self-denying kindness and service to others is the secret to true greatness in the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. A life of self-denying kindness and service to others, the secret to true greatness. So let me just go here for just a minute. We were in this place in a wonderful Sunday school class just a little while ago. I wish you all could have been there. You would have enjoyed it. It would have been enlightening and inspiring. How do you self-identify? How do your kids self-identify? Scotty and I were recently walking with friends whose daughter who just graduated from college self-identifies as they them, not she her, they them. How do you self-identify? One of the things I want to encourage you, young people especially, listen to me. You are going to be given a lot of information as you grow older in school, and you're going to hear a lot of ideas about identity, who you are. I want to encourage you this day to drive a stake in the ground and decide this day that I am going to identify myself the way the Bible identifies me. How does the Bible identify you? You're a person of great dignity and worth because you're an image bearer. The stamp of the divine, the image of God is upon you. That's just one. You're a son. If your faith is in Jesus, you're a son of the living God. You're a daughter of the King. You have immense worth. That's who you are. One day you may grow up and you may be a teacher. You may be a medical professional, a doctor, a dentist, a nurse practitioner. You may be an educator. You may be an entrepreneur, a businessman, a music teacher, whatever it is, a real estate agent. That is not who you are. That is a hat that you wear. That's a role that you play. Here, who are you according to Matthew 20, 20 to 28? You're a servant. You are literally, the word is deacon. You're a deacon. I was watching this happen this week at a restaurant I was in. I was watching one of our students in this church who was bussing tables with a smile on her face, just joyfully caring for people and their different needs. I was there at the table just watching her care for people. That's who the great people are, according to Jesus. The diakonos, the deacons, the table waiters, the bond servants. How is it that a teenage girl can have her life absolutely interrupted, to say the least? You're about to give birth to the Messiah. How does she deal with that when her life is turned topsy-turvy? I am a bond servant of the Lord. Be it done to me as you have said. How do you identify yourself? If I'm a bondservant of Jesus, then he has the absolute right to speak into my life whatever he wants to from his word, and my job is not to question, but to implement and obey. Well, what does a life of self-denying kindness and service to others practically look like? Now, I've just been watching you, okay? These are just a few things from the church. Any one of you, Matt's here from First Baptist on sabbatical. We're so happy to have him and his family. He could get up here and talk about the ways that this is being implemented in his church. A life of self-denying kindness and service to others. How about preparing a meal for a family with sickness? Someone who's dealing with sickness or cancer. You guys are incredible at that. That's happened multiple times this past week and month. Helping a friend fill out a visa application for an emergency trip to another country. How about that? That's an act of service. Helping a widow with household repairs. Visiting a widow faced with the death of her beloved husband. Helping an immigrant, someone who doesn't speak English well, learn how to speak English. Here's another thing you can do if you want to serve. Join our Pray For Me campaign. One of the ways that you can be a servant for Jesus is by praying for the young people and the kids of our church. Well, I was thinking about an illustration of this, and the Lord gave me one recently when I was in North Carolina visiting my mom and dad. This month, my dad will be 82 years old. My mom will be 81. My mom is struggling a bit with her health and not able to do a lot of her normal activities. My dad is a country boy. You might have heard me say, right now, even at 82, he can kick my butt any day of the week. I mean, he is a man's man. His kids adore him. His grandkids worship the ground the man walks on. He is larger than life. What does a life of self-denying kindness look like for an 82-year-old man whose wife is struggling with her health? My dad can grill. I've never seen my dad do anything in the kitchen. I mean, we had grandmama and mama, so we were doubly covered. But you know where my dad is? He's in the kitchen. He goes to the grocery store. I mean, wow, that Publix intimidates me. He's in the grocery store. He's cooking meals. He's not complaining. He's just doing the next right thing to care for his bride. They didn't always have an easy relationship, but he's hung in there. How is it that a man can do that? My dad would be embarrassed if he knew that I was telling you his story right now. He's always been a servant, but one of the things my dad knows, and one of the things I want to submit to you, true greatness, true ultimate greatness, is not so much in serving other people with life, with, you know, life-denying kindness and service. It's allowing yourself to be served by the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the fuel. This is the energy. I just mentioned a few minutes ago, you want to know how far you've advanced in servanthood? How do you respond when someone in your family treats you as a servant? You're going to know probably that you've got some ground to cover. And what I want to just encourage you with is, I want to talk lastly about all the ways that you have been served by the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is the embodiment of true greatness. This is verse 28. This could use a couple sermons, but let's just close with just a few things here. It says, even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Well, one of the things I want you to see here is, who is it that is serving? Just a couple of points here, and we'll move to communion. Who is it that said, I did not come to be served, but to serve? Who is he? What does the text say? What does verse 28, if you've got Matthew 20, 28, what does it say? He's the Son of Man. This is Jesus' favorite designation. He is in solidarity with us. He is fully God and fully man. But let me just remind you where this comes from. This is the figure of Daniel. Remember Daniel's prophecy? Daniel 7, in the throne room of heaven, there's one seated on the throne. His name is the Ancient of Days. And one like the Son of Man is given access into the throne room of heaven. And he is given an eternal dominion. In fact, he's given an everlasting kingdom. And it says that all languages, all peoples, all nations will serve him. And that is the one who comes to take the towel. That is the one who's willing to come and die and bear the weight of sin for you and for me. So he's the Son of Man. This really, in many ways, and I've not done it justice here, this should bring us all to a place of shock and awe that he would do this for me. I don't know about you, but when I think that people owe me and that I deserve better, I become very judgmental and harsh with people, wanting them to serve me. When I realize all that Jesus Christ has done for me, that he paid the ransom for me, it humbles me. And that is the fuel that is going to energize our marriages, our relationships, our work relationships, our church relationships, so that we serve one another, that we serve each other with life denying kindness. Well, let me just close with this one word, ransom. It says, Jesus Christ did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. I've written it here in my Bible. What is a ransom? It's setting captives free by the payment of a purchase price. Friends, you and I, we were slaves to sin and the consequences of sin, death. In fact, those who do not repent and believe on Jesus, Matthew 25, just a few chapters later, they will pay the penalty of everlasting punishment away from the presence of the Lord. But here's the beauty of the gospel, that Jesus Christ redeems, he ransoms us, he pays the price. What's the price? The price is his life for ours, his blood for ours. He dies the eternal death on the cross. He pays for our sin. He endures our hell. He descended into hell. We just read it a minute ago. When did he do that? When he was on the cross. He endured that so that you might know the joys of heaven. Well, the ultimate good news here is the radical call of Christian discipleship. Friends, it isn't a call primarily to serve Jesus. It's a call to be served by Jesus. Many people in many churches in our community are trying to get busy, trying to do all these things for God, but they've never come to receive the gift, the ransom paid, freedom for the captives, that we've been born again into the freedom of the gospel. Well, one of the things that happens is heaven today, some of your own loved ones who've gone on before you, they're called the redeemed. They're singing a new song. They're singing a song of praise to Jesus. It says, who was slain and who by his blood ransomed men and women for God. One of the things I want to ask you, he gave his life as a ransom for many. Are you in that many? Have you come to a place of acknowledging, I need to be ransomed? Somebody's got to pay the price. I'm going to pay it for all eternity, or Jesus has paid it in full on Calvary's cross for me. Have you come to rest in that, to believe in him, to trust his saving power? Well, these two men who were full of themselves, who were just dripping with ego, did they get it? Did James and John get it? You bet your boots they did. After they saw Jesus die on that cross and be raised up triumphantly from the dead. In fact, James drank the cup of suffering. He was the first martyr, really the second. He was the martyr of the Jerusalem church. He was the leader. He was the point person. And he was the first one killed by King Herod. How about John? John was banished to the island of Patmos, kind of like a modern-day concentration camp, because of his loyalty to Jesus. And he is the one who said this. Did they get it? You bet your boots they did. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. Friends, a life of true greatness is found in service to others. But before you get busy trying to serve somebody, would you let the Lord Jesus Christ serve you? This table is a table for sinners. It's a table for people who struggle with ego, self-seeking, self-protection, making a name for ourselves. Jesus Christ, the one who had the absolute right to assert his right, laid them aside to serve you and me on Calvary's cross. And I want to invite you to come and be strengthened by his grace. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took matzah bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup of redemption, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins of many. Take and drink of it. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Friends, these emblems, these are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Would you take them and feed upon Jesus in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving? Let's pray. Father, would you set apart these common elements from their common purpose? Make them the blessed ordinance of the broken body and the shed blood of Jesus, the suffering servant of the Lord, who died to justify and reconcile us to you. And Lord, fill our hearts with adoring wonder and gratitude for all that he's done for us. We make our prayer now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Peace.
demonstrates his own love for us. And while we were ungodly, Christ died for us. Christ died for us once for all to redeem us, to ransom us from the empty way of life that we inherited from our forefathers. We were redeemed not with perishable things, but we were redeemed with the precious blood of the Lamb. For all we like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned aside to his own way. But the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God in Christ Jesus our Lord is the gift of eternal life. Jesus said, I am the bread of life that comes down from heaven. And I give my flesh, my life for the world. I am the resurrection and the life. If anyone believes in me, even if he dies, yet shall he live. Do you believe this? The bread of affliction. Not the affliction of our forefathers. If you're Jewish, that's what this means. It's the affliction of our forefathers in Egypt. That's the bread of his affliction. He was afflicted so that you and I might know the forever smile and the forever joys of the everlasting kingdom. Eat with joy in your heart. Friends, we talked about what you're released from. One of the things, this is the wine of forgiveness, the cup of salvation. Jesus drank the cup. Can you drink the cup? Jesus drank the cup of the undiluted justice of God on sin so that you might know his favor forever. So in light of that, I want to encourage you with Horatio Spafford, my favorite word to say at the moment like this. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not the part of it, but the whole of it, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Let's pray together. Father, words are inadequate to say thanks for your immense sacrifice. You gave your life for ours. You substituted yourself in our place. You were condemned so that we might be forgiven. In our place, you were rejected so that we might be accepted. You were cut off from your Father so that we might forever be welcomed in. May these truths not just inflame our minds, may it ignite a passionate longing in our hearts to serve you and to serve others, even this day. We make our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. I would like for you to stand and receive the Lord's benediction. As you go from this place, I want to encourage you, if you have a particular prayer need, be happy to visit with you and pray with you after the service. If you're interested and you're struggling with where you stand with the Lord, please come and have a visit. We'd love to talk with you. But I want to invite you now, as you go from this place, to receive the Lord's benediction from Numbers chapter 6. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his smiling countenance upon you and give you his shalom, his peace, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you for coming.
His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum thrown in.